This rocket launched the Pioneer 10 probe into outer space. It is the first such projectile to leave our solar system. Its journey will last for over 1,000 years. Should some form of intelligent extraterrestrial life happen to discover it on its way, it will find a gold-plated aluminum plaque mounted on it. It contains information about our planet, a diagram of a hydrogen atom, our position in the universe, the beings who sent the craft, a man and a woman. Will this message ever be read? When? Where? By whom? At the very least, this plaque is proof that our scientists are taking seriously the possibility of intelligent life on other planets, other stars, far beyond our galaxy. I'm William Shatner. As Captain Kirk, and with the rest of the crew of the USS Enterprise, we made many wondrous voyages into the future, into the vastness of space. But that was fiction. I'd like to take you along on another kind of voyage. But this is based on reality, the real world we live in. We're going to look at the Earth and its mysteries from the past, long before recorded time. We're going to examine and perhaps question some widely held theories of what may have happened to this Earth of ours in that mysterious and murky dawn, what we know as civilization. We're going to investigate some strange and bizarre events in the present, unbelievable happenings as fresh as today's headlines. And more important, perhaps, we're going to take a searching and scientific look into the future. We're reaching more and more out into space. Perhaps, as we may learn, someone, something, somewhere in space is reaching out to us. This, then, is an adventure that will take us deep into the past, into our present, and into the future. It's a rich tale from many sources, many investigators, many adventurers. A great explorer, Peter Freuchen, once summed up what we feel about this film. Speaking of the great adventurers, he said, "The stories which these fellows bring us are the stuff our dreams are made of, and in our secret minds, we live them. In our fantasies, we battle the most violent storms, conquer the bravest fighters, bring home the richest cargoes from the most amazing voyages, dive for sunken gold, see the strangest sights, then in the end, science takes over from the imagination, and behold, there are even greater wonders than we dreamed." That's what this picture is all about. Of the millions and billions of stars in the universe, one of the least significant planets in our own stellar system is this one. It is not only a small planet, but very young. There are any number of older ones. How did it begin, this young Earth? From a whirling ball of molten gases, it became a cooling sphere of bubbling, oozing lava. That was some 5,000 million years ago. Somewhere, the oceans and seas appeared, and clouds of moisture formed over them. The lightning came, joined with the amino acids in the sea to begin the chain of what we know as life.
First protozoa, then plants and forests. Some say, as does Erich von Daniken, that this new Earth was visited by beings from older planets. We'll look into that. But early on, 150 million years ago, in the Mesozoic era, dinosaurs roamed the Earth. They left petrified bones and tracks, and a mystery. In the Glen Rose River in Texas, near dinosaur tracks, what appears to be the print of a human-like foot. Strange, incredible, impossible. 2 feet long, the footprint of a giant. We know there were no giants, don't we? Yet, the fourth book of Moses says, "And there we saw the giants, the sons of Anak, who come of the giants. And we were in our own sight as grasshoppers, and so we were in their sight." Side by side, dinosaur prints, and prints that appear to be humanoid. Yet giant footprints like these have been found in South Africa, in China, and Java. We know little of giants. What do we know of man? In Italy, these bits of bone were found in mineral coal sediments. Their age? About 12 million years. They come from a mammal similar to man. Still, more animal than human. In Africa, on the rim of the Serengeti steppes, scientists found remnants of a skeleton now more human than animal. Its age, 2 to 3 million years old. There are 9 million years difference in the age of these two specimens. When did the mutation from animal to human actually occur? We don't know. Closer to us, the Neanderthal man. He first appeared about 150,000 years ago in the Paleolithic era. He died out 100,000 years later. Why? We have no idea. A completely new race of humans come into being. Cro-Magnon man. He got his name from the place where he was found. Cro-Magnon in the Rhone Valley in southern France. A human being from the Ice Age. His accomplishments in a number of areas is remarkable. He knew a regulated social order. He discovered a tool we still use today, the needle. He used it to sew his animal skin clothing. We look at his cave paintings in France and Spain with amazement. And what struck me, these primitive men were capable of painting, interpreting what they saw realistically. What happened back then? We know that man was intelligent, that he had begun living in harmony with others. Scientists speak of the leap of intelligence, this turning point in the history of human development, but they can't explain it. There are other primitive paintings. In Australia, the rock paintings. Look at them. Is this the work of a primitive imagination? Or are they realistic interpretations of what they saw? The tribe of Aborigines whose ancestors made the drawings still live here in the Australian outback. Through their dancing and chanting, they tell a legend of the visit of a godlike creature. The story of Wandinja, goddess of the Milky Way. She came from outer space in her gleaming ship, brought wisdom and guidance, and then returned to the stars. Just to the north, in New Guinea, they tell of a flying god who has dominion over another earth. These are some of their ritual masks. Deep in the Brazilian jungle, on the banks of the Rio Fresca, the Kayapas make their home. The borders of their world, this river and the jungle. Their lives today are as uncomplicated as those of their ancestors. Even today, the Kayapas chant this ancient legend. One day, Bep Karate appeared in the village. He was dressed in a bow, which covered him from head to foot. On his head, he wore a kof, a thunder weapon. Some of the people tried to do battle with the intruder, but their weapons were too weak. Each time they touched Bep Karate's clothing, they turned to dust. This warrior from outer space had to laugh at the fragility of these people who tried to fight him. To prove his strength to them, he took off his kof, his thunder weapon, pointed to a tree, and destroyed it. He lived among them for decades, and then left them forever. The foreigner wore a bow, the legend says. This suit, the ritual garment the Kayapos wear on their most sacred festivals, is still called a bow to this day. Strange. How did it evolve? Is it coincidence that this costume somehow is reminiscent of spacesuits worn by our astronauts? Yes, and even the way the dancer moves. Like our astronauts walking on the moon. These pictures of a bow were taken in 1951. At that time, nobody knew, least of all the Kayapos, what spacesuits would subsequently look like. The first spaceflight around the Earth took place in 1961, 10 years after these pictures were made. In the ancient Mayan temple city of Palenque in Mexico, on this carved plaque, appears a curious figure. To some, it appears to be a warrior. To others, an astronaut at an instrument panel. And in that same ancient Mayan city, these century-old scriptures with illustrations that confuse and confound us to this day, is that a portion of a costume or a piece of technical equipment we might recognize today? What are these figures? Who are they? Is that a headdress or a lamp? Further to the north, in the southwestern United States, I sought out a legend of the Hopi Indians. Today, the Hopis make their home in Arizona. Cliff dwellers, the Hopis were the only Indian tribe to build solid houses. And there are other differences. Their rock drawings of strange mechanized or stylized beings are far different from the drawings of other Indian tribes. Their legend tells of their wanderings as a tribe. They moved from island to island and from there to the mainland. Whenever they left an island, it sank beneath the sea. Only a few Hopi warriors ever reached the mainland, and even they had lost all their weapons. It was then that strange creatures appeared out of the glowing sun. And these creatures brought them tools which were better than the ones they had used before. These creatures looked different from the humans of our world. They had incredible powers, and their magic was stronger than fire and lightning. And they call them Kachinas. The Hopis still make these dolls with their helmet-like heads. The son of the last Hopi chief explained to me the origin of the name and what the dolls represent to them. He said, in the Hopi language, the word Kachina means most respectable, spiritual, intelligent person. Kachinas were those beings who once helped the tribe in their struggle for life. One day they left us. However, they did promise to return. So as not to frighten our children when these strange beings do come back, several generations of Hopis have made their dolls, which look like Kachinas. What is a legend? A myth? A fantasy? Is there a germ of truth or is it fiction? Who are the ancient astronauts, if there were truly ancient astronauts, who inspired these legends? What did they look like? Like these figures from Ecuador? Like this Dogu figure from Japan? Like this man in Palenque? From the beginning of time, the heavens, the source of our legends, have held an incredible fascination for mankind. This ancient astronomical observatory of Stonehenge in England predates recorded history. The stars and our desire to study them, to find out more about their mysteries, have intrigued both primitive and modern man. One of the mysteries, still unanswered, is there life out there? Today, we study the heavens in a different way, as with this gigantic radio telescope of Arecibo in Puerto Rico. Its parabolic mirror antenna has a diameter of over 900 feet, three times the size of a football field, the sharpest ear in the world. It is capable of receiving signals from stellar systems thousands of light years away from our Earth. So far, we've heard sounds from our own galaxy. We know that our universe is not mute. The Milky Way hisses. Saturn growls. The sun sighs. We wait. We listen. For what?
All this presupposes a life form.
Dr. John Billingham of NASA is the head of the SETI program, Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence.
What makes you think that there's life out there? We have indirect evidence only. We do not yet have any direct evidence. The indirect evidence goes as follows. First of all, we now believe that all stars have planets. Essentially, all stars have planets. And there are billions of stars, so there are billions of planets. And if even only a small fraction of those planets had life on them, that would mean millions of life sites in our galaxy alone. Second thing is we can make in the test tube organic chemicals which are the same as those in our bodies. Right. So we think we know the earliest steps of life, and we think that if you have a suitable planet, then life will probably begin. So if you have lots of suitable planets and you know that life will begin, then there must be lots of places where there's life. So to detect other intelligent life, the first thing you have to do is to study everything intensively to see if it is indeed worthwhile to proceed further and do a large-scale search. And so at the moment we're studying.
You have pictures there of projected ideas?
Some ideas.
May I see them?
Sure. Let's just take a look here. This was a study called Project Cyclops, which is a big array or orchard of radio telescopes.
Really?
You see they're all pointing it in the same direction.
Mm-hmm. And you have many of them linked in series?
Yes, they're all linked together to a central data processing building where you point them at a target star, and what you're seeking is a planet going around that star which is giving off radio signals.
Intelligent life?
Intelligent life, transmitting for some reason that we perhaps don't even imagine at the moment, and that's the sort of work we're beginning to get into right now. We don't have that equipment yet.
This here?
This picture is of a possible design for a small space system, which is about 100 feet across.
Mm-hmm.
And it would be the first one that we would try in space, and we would listen with this for a time, and if we didn't hear anything, we might build a larger one in space.
The shuttle would have taken the material out?
The shuttle takes the material.
Built in space?
You build it in space.
Manned or
We're not sure. It would probably be unmanned, but it would be revisited. In other words, you go back every so often to repair it.
Right. And this?
This one is a concept for a lunar version of an array of radio telescopes we would put them on the far side of the moon because radio noise from the Earth does not reach the far side of the moon.
How big is this?
See, each of these is 600 feet across. So they're big.
Incredible.
And then we can... Oh, you go on from this stage, which is the small one,
mm-hmm.
Okay, and you practice with that. You do a small search, but you don't expect really to hear anything with that. And you go on to the next step, which is a 300-meter dish. This is 1,000 feet across.
Right.
Reflects the incoming signal back to a receiver, which is here.
Mm-hmm.
The receiver transmits the signal to a relay satellite, which is here, and then back to the Earth. And here's a shuttle type of vehicle.
Magnificent.
And if you don't hear anything with that system, then you can, if you wish, to continue the search, build an even larger antenna or dish here, which would be even more sensitive, and this is now 10,000 feet in diameter.
Listening all the time
for
an intelligent voice. Why?
Right.
Why would we do this?
I think there are many reasons. A lot of people are saying that our own civilization is unlikely to last more than a few more decades for a variety of reasons. And if we were to hear only one other civilization, we would know that there is certainly a chance that we could last many hundreds or thousands or millions of years into the future, because they would be much older than us.
I see. This, of course, is an astronaut at work on that...
On the edge of the very large dish. You can see the size. That's the shuttle vehicle and another one. With that type of system, you might well be able to pick up a very faint signal. This is an alternative concept for the system on the far side of the moon, and these are built, the one at Arecibo in Puerto Rico is built. In listening for signals of possible extraterrestrial origin, you have to have a very sensitive receiver. You have to have a data processor which splits up the spectrum into millions of channels, and then you have to have something which would recognize a pattern. If there was an intelligent signal, it would come out as some sort of pattern.
What is your speculation about that intelligent life having come here already, or indeed having been here already?
Probes from other civilizations could have come here in the past. You see, life has been present on the Earth for 4 billion years. And even if a probe only came once every billion years, we would have been visited 4 times. However, all traces of evidence of such visits, unless we were very lucky, would have long since disappeared.
Have all the traces of evidence disappeared? Around the world, there are many mysteries that still baffle us. Could they be such evidence? In the South Pacific, the little island of Temuin, but this is not the name the natives call it. They call it Nan Madol. This was once Nan Madol. Now it is only ruins. Only this small area is still accessible. Nan Madol seems foreign to the South Seas. These gloomy structures seem to have been transplanted from another world. Wide stretches of the foundation walls are still visible. The rest has been swallowed up by the jungle. Over 400,000 basalt pillars were piled on top of each other in 80 separate structures, many of them over 30 feet high. Individual beams, up to 40 feet long, weighing over 10 tons. 10 tons, the weight of 10 automobiles. Who built this gigantic structure here? And why? How many laborers did they have? Where did they all live? No, not on this little island. How did they transport those basalt beams? Questions, but no answers. When the natives are asked, they say nothing. But their legend tells us an alien god with a fire-spouting dragon only needed to pronounce a magic spell, and the huge basalt beams came flying across the sea from their distant quarry, landing in a neat pile. What of these unexplained mysteries? How was it possible for men alone, primitive men, to have accomplished these things? A dragon? No, hardly. But so they say it was something breathing fire. The stones of Karnak in Brittany, over 13 rows of them, several miles long, 3,000 separate blocks. Their age, over 5,000 years old. Why were they put up? And for whom? Science tells us, altars to the gods. Nobody says what gods. The wall blocks of Sacsayhuaman in Peru. The square stone terraces of Baalbek. The Moai on Easter Island. These huge granite spheres in the forests of Costa Rica, for what purposes were they made? Von Daniken suggests they were monuments to spaceships, similar to these science fiction illustrations. Another mystery. The curious tracks on the high plateau of Nazca in southern Peru. They have a resemblance to modern-day landing fields. But these tracks were laid down thousands of years ago. I put some questions to Dr. Dennis Hauck, North American director of the International UFO Registry.
Some of these mysteries, like the Nazca Plains, how would you explain them?
I think the Nazca Plains have been mistreated in the literature. There's much more information there than is generally available. The Nazca Plains have been presented as so much graffiti which the extraterrestrials put on the plains for our enjoyment or their enjoyment. And actually, there's a great many more mysteries involved there. The Nazca Plains have only been known to mankind for 30 years. They were discovered by a commercial airline pilot. And if you're down on the ground in the plains, you see no marks. You see nothing. It's just a grassy area. In fact, the Pan American Highway was built right across the plains. No one noticed anything. But from a commercial airliner or from an airplane, you can see bits of the Nazca Plain. The Nazca Plain is 300 square miles around, and you really can't see the entire plane unless you're in space. The entire plane is very, very much covered with hematite, which is iron oxide. And as far as being a spaceship going to a planet, and if you were to do a magnetospheric survey of the planet, which we might assume would be done, the Nazca Plains would stand out like a red light. They would be a distortion of the field because of the rich iron deposits there. It's by far the biggest area on the planet Earth of this type of iron oxide deposits. The plane itself, when we look at the iron deposits, we find that there are actually rails running slightly below the ground. They're rusted now, but they're probably about 1,500 years old, perhaps 1,000 years old. We have
about the same age as the
plane itself and the markings.
The markings on the plane. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. The railings are about 22 feet apart, and when we think now, what could they be used for? We have a number of connections. one thing, the average size, average diameter of UFOs that we see today happens to be 21.5 feet. A very close coincidence there.
Do you think that they visited ancient man by example and perhaps with actual help, implanted ideas that became the inspiration for many of the mysteries that we now think of as the mysteries of the gods?
This is the key, I think, to an intelligent understanding of the ancient astronauts' effect on our lives in the past and present. The people, I don't think, these artifacts that we find that are so hard to explain do not fit in the culture. They do not fit the religious customs of the culture. It seems like there was a tremendous inspiration to make these artifacts on the part of the people. And I think that this inspiration finds its source with extraterrestrial intervention.
If they did intervene, how did they intervene? And why? There is a gap that has plagued anthropologists for a long time. Why? One minute, in Earth time, man is still living in grottos and caves, and then, in a very short space of time, he begins erecting structures unmatched in perfection to this day. Did some decisive change come over the human brain at this point in time? How did prehistoric people learn to produce architectural masterworks? Consider Chan Chan in northern Peru, the capital city of the Shimu people. Shimu culture was already ancient when the Incas came here. 200,000 people once lived in these clearly geometrically organized streets and walls. Urban planning like this presupposes an organized mind, highly developed thinking powers. The Shimu had it. These golden figures were found under the ruins of Chan Chan, 20 inches high. The characters are engraved in each of 56 rectangles. An alphabet, all scholars agree to that. But to this day, no one has succeeded in deciphering it. The ancient Mayan city of Uxmal in Mexico, a magnificent architectural style. The ornamentation, graceful filigree work in stone. Pyramids with 365 steps, one for each day of the year. A calendar more accurate than our own. It manages without a leap year. Where did the Mayans learn the laws of astronomy? Tikal rises today out of a sea of giant jungle trees. This is the largest and oldest Mayan city, now being slowly freed from the jungle. These buildings are more stern, more somber. No one knows why the Mayans suddenly decided to leave cities like these to establish new settlements. Who or what forced the Mayans to change locations? There are other technological mysteries. Deep in the Bolivian jungle, on a hill, there is a structure that scientists have wondered about for years. Von Daniken went there on a research expedition. The view from the ground, a labyrinth of terraces, winding stairs, and rock seats. Scholars say this could be some kind of altar. What was the purpose of these two stone tracks, each about a foot wide? There is much here that is unexplained. Rock terraces, no explanation. Stone grooves, no explanation. A stone dome in the middle of the water basin. Holes in the rock connected by a conduit system. What was this? Russian archaeologists answered that question with this drawing of a prehistoric metal washing plant in Soviet Armenia. This is how they say it worked. The precious metal remains behind while the lighter stone is rinsed away. Metals washed here included silver, gold, and platinum. The face, hands, and the rim of the sphere on this piece are all platinum, as well as the eyes on this golden mask. Platinum melts at 3,216 degrees Fahrenheit. From ancient technology, I went to the scene of the most advanced technology in the world, at NASA's Kennedy Space Center at Cape Canaveral. In the firing room at the Cape, where the Apollo and Skylab missions were fired into space, I talked with Mr. Jesco von Puttkamer, senior staff scientist, Office of Spaceflight for NASA. The blinking colored lights of the consoles simulated the actual activity during the countdown of a launch.
What is NASA's opinion of the possibility of life in outer space?
We have concluded that you can create life building blocks in the laboratory, which could mean that it's just as easy out in the universe.
Could you give me a clear mathematical probability of the existence of life in outer space?
One.
One to one?
One is certainty.
Oh, one is certainty.
One is certainty.
So NASA feels that it's certain.
Yes.
What is the official opinion of UFOs? Do you accept the idea that UFOs exist?
No doubt. No doubt. I accept that.
There is no doubt that unidentified flying objects exist.
Yes.
The only question is where they came from.
And what they are. I don't think that UFOs are flying spaceships. We have often been accused in NASA that some of our spaceships going to the moon have been followed by UFOs, and that the astronauts and NASA is withholding information on UFOs. And I can assure you that this is not the case.
Do you think extraterrestrial beings could have come here 5,000 years ago?
If our so-called Big Bang theory of the creation of the universe applies, that means the universe had a beginning at a certain point in time, like 18 billion years ago, then most of the galaxies and the suns are more or less of the same age. This fact alone would indicate to me that the likelihood of having a very fast, very far advanced civilization out there is very low.
Well, let me take another attack then. How long a period of time do you think it will take before man will go out and explore space?
Depending on the priority given to this, it would be a matter of maybe 25 to 30 years to fly to Mars, and maybe another 20 years to fly out to Jupiter.
Therefore, it's not beyond the realm of possibility that a civilization that was 100, 200, maybe 1,000 years in advance of us would have vehicles that could come to Earth.
Certainly not. That would definitely be possible.
What do you think of von Daniken's theory that extraterrestrial beings came here 5,000 years ago and gave us information that we're now beginning to use?
I think it's an interesting theory. I have not been convinced by the so-called evidence that we indeed were visited, but I'm wide open to new developments. One puzzle in science which is relevant here is the genetic code, the DNA code in our human biology, which is rather complicated and which right now is very difficult to explain if we assume evolution of men on Earth alone. There are some questions which cannot right now be answered in the area of how did our biological genetic code evolve, unless it was possibly imported from somewhere else.
Our brain, No one has ever been able to explain it. Over 14,000 million brain cells in the cerebral cortex alone. These are brain cells enlarged 200,000 times. Each of them reacts to the tiniest electrical impulses, a switching system vastly superior to anything modern technology has ever been able to create. One explanation, it could have been developed through a crossbreeding between primitive man and beings from other planets.
As you know, it's been said that our brain is one of the biggest mysteries in itself. Are we not looking at something that is deep in our ancient history?
Indeed, we have a racial memory, perhaps, of visitations or at least contact when we were more primitive, perhaps, in a more primitive state. This entire thing about the quantum leap that the human race took towards intelligence and self-conscious behavior is very mysterious, that there is a missing link, that there must have been intelligent interference at some time in evolutionary history. We know that apes and the humanoid types that we evolved from had 48 Y chromosomes, whereas today a human being has 46 X chromosomes, which is quite a change genetically, and there's a possibility, I think, that it was induced.
Could it be possible? Could intelligent beings from other planets have visited us, and we are the products of those visits? In the Lamech scroll, an ancient Semitic writing, Bat Enoch assures her husband, Noah's father, that she did not sleep with the watchmen of heaven. Who were these watchmen? Henoch, a Jewish prophet, is even more specific. He gives this reproach to the watchmen of heaven. Why did you leave heaven? Sleep with our women. Befoul yourselves with the daughters of man, as the sons of earth once did, begetting giant sons. In South America, near the borders of Peru and Bolivia, there is this legend. Many years ago, on the day the sun was at its highest point, something like a house descended from the sky. It looked like a blazing golden vessel. There were no clouds in the sky. Nevertheless, the earth trembled as if struck by a mighty clap of thunder. The horrified people threw themselves on the ground. Only Actacuma remained standing. He was the bravest and best. This golden house-like thing land on the silver disk of Lake Titicaca. Then suddenly all the noise stopped. Oriana stood before him, the goddess of heaven. She chose Actacuma to be her husband and bore him many children. Then one day she returned to the heaven from the silvery surface of Lake Titicaca in her golden vessel. The Indios who live in this region today still tell that story. Only a few years ago in Peru, the most astonishing archaeological discovery was made. The stones of Ica. When the small river Ica changed its course, suddenly thousands of these stones could be seen in what had been the riverbed. Stones with meticulously carved illustrations on them. An expert in this field stated, "I believe that the discovery of the stones of Ica is the most important archaeological find of this century. They represent visible proof that civilizations about which we previously knew nothing existed thousands of years ago." These stones illustrate the course of open-heart surgery. The doctor and the intern administer the anesthesia. On the right, the doctor bends over the patient. The operation begins. The doctor on the left has opened the thorax. While the doctor ties off the arteries, he is handed more instruments. Above left, the doctor's hands holding the heart. Notice the detail with which the heart was illustrated that long ago. We know of successful skull operations which took place thousands of years ago. This skull is 4,000 years old, proof that this kind of surgery took place, like this stone of Ica. Some of the other illustrations on the stones are just as amazing. Dinosaurs. World maps. A man with a magnifying glass. A man with a telescope 3,000 years ago. Our telescope was invented only 400 years ago. If you and I could accept the theory that beings from outer space intervened with humans, could it have been to give us technology, to supply us with information from a higher culture? This is the ancient Mayan city of Lubantun. It was here that only a few years ago was found a most beautiful and mystifying object. A skull made of purest mountain crystal. The skull is cut from a single piece of crystal, yet there are no visible traces of tooling even viewed under a high-powered microscope. We don't know its exact age. It could be 3, maybe 5,000 years old. Many say it was from the ancient astronauts or inspired by them. I flew to Kitchener, Ontario to take a personal look at the crystal skull and to meet its owner, Miss Anna Mitchell-Hedges.
We've used the modern airplane to come and see something very ancient. Crystal skull, it's ominous, it's awesome. Has the skull brought goodness or badness to people?
One girl from Australia came to see the Folly Castle, and she laughed at it when my father was giving a lecture, and my father was very angry at the time, so he closed the box, and he wouldn't lecture on it anymore, because he has strong belief in the crystal skull that has more power than any gods that we have. And months later, two young Australian came, and they asked to see the crystal skull. So we knew that somebody must have told them. And I called my father in, and he said, "Well, why do you want to see it?" I said, "Well, we have a special reason we like to see it, because the girl that laughed at it about 3 months ago told us on her dying bed to come to see the crystal skull, but please do not laugh at it." She was sure that her death was
due
because she laughed at the crystal skull.
You found it?
Yes, I found it.
Your father was an archaeologist?
Yes.
And he was doing the diggings in that area?
In that area.
And you were there as a child?
I was with him.
As a child?
As a child, 10 years of age. My father said this is where the Maya started from. And after years of clearing the ground there and lifting stones, which are huge stones, they had to take two people to lift them and to place them, so they wouldn't, nobody would have an accident with them. And I saw something shining, and the sun was throwing on it. And I got the Maya people to help me to lift the, clear this ground. And of course we found the top of the crystal, the head. Mm-hmm. And 3 months later, we found the jaw. The theater where we found the crystal skull was 8 square miles.
My goodness. How many people would collect in an 8 square mile theater?
Oh, thousands of people, thousands.
My gosh, I'm trying to put myself back into time and space, back to when the skull was used for religious ceremonies. Can you describe to me how it was used, who used it, where it was used?
Well, for instance, it is written down on stones, carved in stones there, that this was used by the high priest of the Maya for willing death or to heal. Mm-hmm. And particularly for an old witch doctor or wise man, medicine man, he was getting too old to perform his work. A young man was chosen who had belief in become a medicine man. And both were laid in front of the altar, and the high priest would perform the ceremony, and the knowledge of the old man would go all into the young boy, mm-hmm. and the old man then would pass away peacefully, and this young boy would get up as a man, knowledgeable and ready to perform the same ceremony as the old man did.
Can you tell me what kind of testing was done on the skull to authenticate it?
It's been examined in San Francisco for 6 years.
And what did they find?
They found that no tool was ever touched it.
And no tool? No tool has
no
ever
tool.
Touched it?
No tool. It's all hand done. They rubbed it down with hot sand and different herbs. And it took 5 generations to rub down. But it had to be the same family from 5 generations, religious.
5 religious generations of families.
Yes.
Their whole function was to make the skull?
All done by hand.
Yes. And rubbed by sand and by herbs?
By sand and herbs. Hot sand.
And about how many years would you say?
150 years to rub down.
Continuously.
To get it perfect.
But the information that the ability to make the skull was known by the Mayans and not by the ancient astronauts?
Yes, I would believe an astronaut has a lot to do with it, but Mayan and Inca, which are more astronaut.
Could you explain that a little bit more? Mm. Could you just give me a little more detail about what you mean by the astronaut and the...
Well, we know that people have come to this Earth before we have.
Mm-hmm.
And they were definitely astronauts, weren't they?
I
this is my belief, and this is the Maya belief.
I see.
We look up, stretch our arms to the skies, seeking the gods as man has done since he first stood erect. We worship beings from the heavens, beings with wings. Somehow, to humans, wings are almost synonymous with divinity. Christian angels, Ezekiel's wheel, the ancient winged god Garuda of Thailand. The strange beings in winged discs worshipped by the Sumerians. Tekendama, the principal god of the Shimu people. Perhaps these early people were representing more than just spiritual gods. In Egypt, a number of winged beings. Among them, this wooden model, over 2,000 years old. For a long time, it was thought it represented a bird. No bird in the world has raised tail feathers like this. Gliders do. And these from Peru. Birds? No. No bird has wings under his body, or vertical tail feathers, or a delta wing. Curious. And somehow disquieting. And other puzzling discoveries. What are these? Messages from the gods? Or to the gods? Symbols for people who walk the earth? Carvings like these are only recognizable from high altitudes. On the ground, they look like arbitrary, meaningless furrows. Was South America the favorite landing spot for ancient astronauts? Were these carvings for them? These in England, the white horses of Uffington. There's no way of dating them. Now they are easily recognized, as the local people have been paving them with white gravel annually for years. In the immediate vicinity, the Hill of the Sun Gods, also impossible to date. 12,500 miles away, in the jungles of Venezuela, this hill, the same shape and size, also for the sun gods. But who were the sun gods? A saltpeter desert in northern Chile. Lonely, desolate. From the air, archaeologists discovered this hill slope, chiseled in the sandstone, figures. A winged creature. Geometric signs, and next to them, what appears to be with little doubt, writing. Messages directed to the sky? To whom? This carving in northern Chile, discovered only recently, a robot-like figure with a rectangular antenna head carved into the sandstone 390 feet long. What he's holding in his hand suggests a greater mystery. An aerodynamic form that exists nowhere in nature, a projectile known as a boomerang, unique to the Aborigines of Australia. How could these primitive people have ever discovered the aerodynamic refinement of a weapon that returns to the thrower if it misses its target? It's unlikely it could have been copied or invented by coincidence. Could the gods have brought us the gift of civilization? Was their knowledge cached in the mind of early man, seeds planted long ago that has only recently surfaced and flourished, the Industrial Revolution? The giant steps of our advancing technology? Is this a gift of the gods? Is this... Are they watching? A UFO? More and more people claim to have seen them. These pictures are considered genuine by people who believe in UFOs. This was taken on May 23rd, 1971. Look at the cloud formation. Unchanged on this photograph, but the object is now in the upper left. In other words, it has moved. Are they just watching us? Are they gathering information? Do they exist? Unidentified flying objects or optical illusions? I spoke again with Dr. Dennis Hauck.
As a mathematician, you're eminently qualified because of your training to observe and analyze UFOs. What got you interested?
I became interested while I was in graduate school in Vienna, Austria. We were on a skiing holiday to Innsbruck, Austria, and myself and two companions had come upon a UFO as we went over a ridge on the Nordkitten range. We saw the object, what we thought was an object, hovering in front of a boulder about 250 feet in front of us across a small ravine, and it was grayish shaped. It looked like it was spinning. At least it had that shimmering effect, and we were very excited. We threw up our skis and started running towards it, and as we approached the object, it actually disappeared in front of our eyes. And as I look back on the sighting, I think perhaps it was an optical illusion, but in any case, it got me very interested in the problem of UFOs.
you saw what you thought was a UFO then, a flying saucer. Looking back now with more information at your fingertips, you consider it now an aberration of nature, something that was naturally there that you took to be a UFO.
Correct. Yeah.
So we seem to have a problem in discriminating between what are unidentified flying objects and what aren't.
It's a major problem in ufology, I think.
Well, you have some pictures here that illustrate that pretty well, I think. For example, here,
number of photographs of things that, if you weren't knowledgeable, you could take to be unidentified flying objects, flying saucers, in fact.
Right. These show up in the field quite a bit and create what we call noise, bad reports. For instance, this one from the Gemini 7 shot, you see these pentagon-shaped objects that really are lens flares.
Right. And this one here, an obvious fake, huh?
It's a noctilucent cloud. It's a cloud that glows of its own accord from the static literature. Here are lenticular clouds, which are saucer-shaped clouds appearing over.
And then, something more mysterious, the real thing.
The real thing, at least what we believe to be the real thing.
Here, the saucer-shaped vehicle with the dome on the top.
A unique shape, which is coming up in recent years, more and more reported. We're getting away from that pie-shaped, pan-shaped objects and into this.
Then you believe that there is such a thing as a UFO with an intelligence inside it that is not ours, not human.
I think that is one of the characteristics which we can assume. UFOs behave in most cases in a linear fashion, a purposeful fashion. They do not, they seem to have a motive behind this is true in all categories, nocturnal lights, daylight disk, close encounters. We have this linearity of purpose and in many cases linearity of behavior. That is, they don't show up in one part of the sky and then just disappear and show up in another part. You can usually trace their motions and movements. They interact. They have this interactability with our environment and with our physical world. In other words, they leave traces in the ground. They leave UFO rings.
There is some evidence of that, too.
Yeah, there are some good examples here of rings.
Right here, of the burnt-out areas. Where was this? In Australia?
That's Melbourne, Australia. And there are over 300 such rings seen in conjunction with UFO sightings. These aren't just patches in the ground, because there is a fungus which will cause these patches, but these are seen in conjunction with UFO sightings in numerous cases.
Can you deduce something of their characteristics, their intelligence, their motivation, by their actions?
Mathematically or logically, there's not much to deduce there. We haven't had any contact, and that in itself is a hint, I think, to the motivation behind the UFO occupants, if there is such a thing, or the UFO intelligences. They don't care about interacting with us, at least on our conscious level. They're not, they don't really care about meeting human beings at the present time. There's something about the way they act I don't like personally. There's a belief in the field that UFOs are benign, that they're here to save us. Sometimes I have to wonder about that belief, because simply the way they behave.
What could you speculate would be their motivation? I mean, if it wasn't benign, would it be harmful?
Of course, there's a possibility, but I think they really don't care one way or the other. I think they're here perhaps for their own motives, which we can't understand their motives, but whatever it is, I think it's wrong to think they're here to save the world, and I think it's wrong to think that they're here to destroy it.
I wonder if it's not an attempt by so many people to explain the inexplicable.
It's used that way. The very idea of UFOs is used that way. It's misused.
Misused, abused perhaps, and widely disbelieved. How, the skeptics say, could an extraterrestrial travel the vast distances? The distances between the Earth and the other solar systems are so great that no human being could ever travel them in his lifetime, unless he were able to travel at much greater speeds than are known to us today. Even if we could actually travel at the speed of light, a space crew would still need centuries to get from one solar system to another. Einstein proved that isn't true with his theory of relativity. At these high speeds, time dilations go into effect. The greater the speed, the less time passes. This table shows how that works on a spaceship traveling at a speed of 500 million miles an hour. On the left, the years which pass for the ship's crew. On the right, the elapsed years for the same time period on Earth. After 15 years of spaceflight, 80 years have already passed on Earth. The longer the rocket is underway, the greater the difference between the time which passes on board the ship and the years on the Earth. The longer the spaceship is en route, the greater the difference between the time in the ship and the time on the ground. After 50 years in the rocket, 420,000 years have passed on Earth. Close UFO contacts have been reported from Pascagoula, Mississippi, from Fargo, North Dakota, from Liberty, Kentucky. I spoke with Officer Bill Patrick of the Stony Point, New York Police Department, and with Sergeant Tom Garace of Haverstraw.
What did you see?
The first sighting that we had reported to us was on the 21st of August, a little after 1 in the morning. And I responded to the call, and it was Mr. and Mrs. Gus Gizzes said that they were watching a star, and that it seemed to be a false sighting star, but they could notice a little bit of light in it. So Mr. Gizzes got out some binoculars and looked at it, and he could see a distinct red and green flashing light coming from the star, and he called me over there, and I observed the same thing as he explained to me, exactly as he explained it to me.
What makes you gentlemen think that it wasn't a balloon or a meteorite or something like that?
Well, because the way it was so erratic, you know, it stayed still for so long, and it had this aluminum green light, a strobe red and a strobe white. And then all of a sudden, from that standing position, it took off at a very high rate of speed.
This was, of course, a different sighting from Officer Patrick.
It was the same night that Officer Patrick was on, because I was talking to the desk officer, and he said he was out there observing the same thing.
Have you seen it at any other time?
Yes, I did, over the Lubbock power plant.
You've seen it over the Lubbock power plant?
On the first sighting, we really didn't think it was some sort of UFO. We thought maybe it was a satellite, a weather satellite or something to that extent.
What made you change your mind?
Well, we had numerous other sightings. Between the 21st and the 30th, we had 9 sightings. And they were observed by some 7 people in the town. And we had some 7 police officers also confirm the sightings. There was movement in the what appeared to be a star. And it would move in one direction, then turn and go into the other direction.
I observed the light for 45 minutes in the west end of our town here. And the light just stayed there for at least 40 minutes. Then when it did take off, it took off at a very high velocity into the northwest section of our town.
Have you seen lights over the power plant too?
Yeah. The first sighting was a UFO that hovered over the power plant for about 45 minutes.
And you saw it clearly?
That was right. That was on the 21st of August.
And you saw that too?
I certainly did.
And there were a number of other officers and people who have seen it?
Yes, as a matter of fact, I have my whole family and my neighbors. They were all watching.
All over the power plant?
All over the power plant.
Can you speculate on anything that they might have been doing?
It just seems that they might have been observing us.
Thank you.
There's a certain amount of imminence about all this, isn't there?
Oh, yes, definitely.
Just north of Stony Point, New York, on the Hudson, I met with Dan Cetrone.
Would be very heavy now through 1977. Plus, you add to that atomic site right across the river, and you've got a perfect sighting area.
Well, that seems to follow a rather human pattern.
Well, there's nothing saying that there's none human about these extraterrestrials.
The atomic sites across the country seem to attract them?
Absolutely. There's a high incidence there. They're not...
Dan is a parapsychologist, gathering information on UFOs.
You mean it's possible that the extraterrestrial beings in those UFOs think like human beings?
Not so much think like human beings. I'm sure they understand our thinking. But we have to get ready for some very extreme ways of thinking, extreme ways of viewing things. They're obviously beyond us in technology.
You lead a center in the New York area,
you have a command center where people can phone in and report sightings. How many sightings do you get?
We average about 50 legitimate sightings a week now if you cover the area of Connecticut and Westchester and Rockland. The ones that we investigate are about 25 a week.
You have various means of detecting the presence of
UFOs, don't you?
Yeah, this is based on the research we did into the occurrence of people in automobiles and their engines would stop. At first, most of the pseudo-investigators said, well, in his panic, he turned the motor off. Well, that's kind of nice, but after we reviewed 1,000 cases on paper, not individually, we found that 1,000 people are not going to just turn the motor off. So we decided to investigate, and at that time, 2 years ago, we found that there's a magnetic disturbance, and that magnetic disturbance somehow interferes with the car. But it gave us a tool. And what we've done is we have a detector, which will, as a result of the magnetic field interference, close a relay and either automatically set in a set off a camera or set off an alarm. And as a result, we're capable now of tracking them by setting up several of these detectors. We're going to use this to get the photographic evidence that we want.
Describe to me your sighting.
Okay, it came up over here, hesitated over the river, as you see here, and then zoomed to the atomic site, stayed over the atomic site, and this is not the first time we've seen them over the atomic site.
What about the future? What do you think the future holds for us if we are visited as it has been predicted?
Mm-hmm. I can't go on just if we're. I must go on when we're, because I put a lot of preparation to it, and I also would like to establish the fact that there's no doubt in my mind at all. It would have to be, as I mentioned before, scientific cowardice for someone to look at all the evidence and say either there was a very highly advanced civilization preceding ours or extraterrestrials came. Now, when we look at our ancient scriptures and they all say, yeah, they shall return, and now we're seeing evidence that they're attempting to come back, and many people that are level-headed, and I consider myself level-headed, I consider myself intelligent, are preparing for it. It's inevitable that they are going to contact
what
us.
What will happen?
I think that there'll be a eighth day of creation type. I think that that's a catch-all phrase, meaning our next stage. We have gone as far as we can on this particular planet by ourselves, and now we need help to get us beyond it.
At the Kennedy Space Center in Cape Canaveral, near the giant Saturn V rocket, I met with Dr. Richard Yinger.
I think it tells us something about where we are going as a species. Space, as I see it, and the travel into space, is a natural part of our evolution as human beings.
Do you think we're trying to find something?
I think we're trying to find our way home is what we're trying to do. I think that what we are part of a tremendously long migration out of the what we think might have been the Olduvai Gorge in Africa, where we might have begun as some ancestor. And now we've migrated to virtually every part of the planet, and there was no place else to go. We're going out into space. I feel sometimes like we are something like the salmon who are trying to spawn back upstream to go back to their original place. And I think this is what we are doing as human beings. What I'm saying is
Richard Yinger is a professor of social sciences and the director of the Exosociology Institute in Lake Worth, Florida.
Coming to Earth. Dr. Yinger, you are an exosociologist.
That's right, yes.
What does that mean?
It means the study of the possibility of life in outer space as a social reality. In other words, what I've been trying to do is to study it as a social fact rather than as some kind of a concrete fact. And I took this from the area of exobiology. In exobiology, we have astronomers who are also biologists who are looking for life in outer space in terms of biology. We need to look at the concept of life in outer space and what impact it could have. If you research in archaeology and anthropology, you find that we are the most mysterious thing we know of in the universe right now as human beings.
We may be spacemen ourselves?
We, in fact, could be spacemen. What we find in studying archaeology and anthropology is that there is no evidence to prove that we as human beings originated on this Earth. There is all kinds of evidence to suggest that we might have originated somewhere in outer space, that indeed there could have been beings from outer space who came here millions of years ago and produced this thing that we now call the human being. Our brain is one of the great mysteries of this universe. We don't know. We cannot explain within the theory of organic evolution how we got our brain. It just doesn't fit in. It evolved too fast. Right now, we have a brain that we aren't using the full potential. A million years ago, we weren't even beginning to use the full potential of the brain. Now, we know that if we don't use something, it will atrophy, it will disappear. And yet, the brain has not disappeared. Something keeps it going. It's like it was built for a purpose that we have not yet reached, and we are, I think, moving toward that purpose.
Is it within the realm of possibility that we will become the visiting astronauts to other worlds?
Yes.
As we were supposed to have been visited?
Yes. We are doing genetic research right now at Harvard and MIT universities. We don't know what's going to happen with that genetic research. It's very dangerous. So what we're going to have to do is go to some other place to do the research. The first logical place would be the moon. We could go to the moon, set up laboratories, remote-controlled laboratories, do our research, and then from there we would move out into space and do even more elaborate experiments. And maybe we would eventually go into another part of the universe, find a planet very much like Earth, and begin to do a very, very fancy kind of experiments, which would then produce, in maybe 4 million years, the same kind of creature that we are here on this Earth today. I think that what we see happening now is the closing of the circle. We have now reached the point where we have the technology to do what those ancient astronauts might have done when they came to the Earth. And so we, like a flower sowing its seeds, are going into the universe to sow another seed. It's almost like this is a garden, and we're moving on now to plant and sow a new garden.
Thank you, Doctor. Do you have any thoughts on the ability for us to contact UFOs through telepathy, through our ability to contact them mentally?
Though I am in total agreement that we are heading towards the point where they will contact us. They will not just land somewhere and run a risk of being mugged. They will land somewhere where they're going to be greeted by people who are perhaps in the right, what you call, frame of mind and with the right interests.
You mean there are people being prepared?
Oh, obviously, yeah.
To receive an extraterrestrial visitor?
I'm being prepared, to be specific, I'm being prepared for the frame of mind that is necessary to greet a extraterrestrial visitor. That's as specific as I can be.
Right, that's pretty specific.
Do you think that some of us, or maybe all of us, are being sent messages by these beings, these things from outer space?
I think some of us are. I think that there are some of us who have come to that point in our own lives where our own consciousness has been literally raised to the point where the difference between us and the extraterrestrials is very, very narrow. And I think that they feel that kind of sympathy that a person could project and could be actually giving them messages. I have felt this myself. I have felt this very intensely.
Do
myself,
you feel
personally.
That you're one of them?
Yes, personally.
That your level of consciousness has been raised to that point?
Yes.
Do you think that you will be contacted, that you will be one of those that will be contacted?
And not necessarily myself. I think that my mission, if there is such a thing, is more in getting other people ready for it. In other words, my main mission, I think, is to speak to academicians, to the other sociologists, to scholars who consider themselves to be serious scientists.
And tell them what?
And tell them that it's time to stop laughing at the idea that there could be life in outer space, to stop laughing and making fun of people like Erich von Daniken, and start to look seriously at what the man has to say. To begin to see that there is some tremendous value in considering ourselves as part of a life system that goes throughout the universe and not something exclusive to this planet.
Is there life out there? Many people, responsible scientists, in and out of our government, agree to the possibility. We have sent a message, a calling card, into space. These are official NASA photographs of what we must term UFOs. NASA has investigated thoroughly and checked what these objects might have been. There has never been a completely accepted explanation. This, from the Apollo 11 flight to the moon in 1969. from the Mercury Project, Atlas 7. From Gemini in 1966. There have always been people gifted with some special sense, capable of looking into the future, who predicted events they couldn't possibly have known about, the oracles of ancient history. The physician Nostradamus in the Middle Ages. Recently, there was this headline. Jean Dixon has an amazing gift for accuracy in her prophecies and predictions. She warned of President Kennedy's assassination long before it happened. She predicted the suicide of Marilyn Monroe and the murder of Robert Kennedy a year in advance. I met with her in her garden in Washington, D.C.
Was that a prediction? Or
that was a prediction. Those were man-made plans. Hadn't he walked out there that day, it would not have happened.
I want to talk to you about a prophecy.
Jean, the prediction I'd like to ask you about is the one that appeared in the National Enquirer some time ago about UFOs and about extraterrestrial beings that would land on Earth sometime next August.
When I was a little child, my German governess says, you know, you wish on a star, wish me, give me the wish I wish tonight. You know, you do those kind of things. So I got out there, and I do the things now that I did when I was little. And I said, wish me, give me the wish I wish tonight. And I wondered about the UFOs and about the holy immortals. And then I had this feeling, this vision of this UFO. Of course, it looked sort of like a top, a large, large top. But of course, I knew that it was not made with nuts and bolts and that. I knew it was some celestial thing, at least I thought it was. And all of a sudden, I seemed to be on the inside of it, not on the outside of it. But then the inside seemed so much bigger than the outside. And I felt at home. I mean, it wasn't strange at all, and I wasn't frightened. And there seemed to be others in there with me, other people. I could not see their faces, but they were smaller. I felt they were smaller than what I was. But then they were dressed in beautiful metallic material of some kind. Everything was nice and smooth, and I could feel the power of vibrations, tremendous vibrations, tremendous thinking power. And then I thought, well, maybe I'm being told that we upon this earth must have a greater power in our thoughts. And then soon it seemed to come on the ground, or I could see the lights of a great city. And I imagined, or at least I thought, the vibrations and measuring time. That was probably a year away, and that would be next August.
The time when the UFOs would land
would
on
land,
Earth
yes.
would be a year away, and that
a
was
year, that would be about
this coming August of 1977.
Yes. But I couldn't tell what part of the world I was in, but it was a large city because it had large lights and it was an important city.
You were successful in telling to the world that President Kennedy would die, that Robert Kennedy would die, that Martin Luther King would die, that Marilyn Monroe would die. And now you're telling us that extraterrestrial beings will land on Earth.
On Earth.
In August.
I am measuring the time, and I think it will be August. I could be off in my timing a little bit, one way or another, but it will be. It will be.
Voyage, you and I. A voyage exploring some of the mysteries of our Earth, our past. Mysteries that go beyond recorded time. We've examined and questioned some many widely held theories of what may have happened in those hazy, early moments of our civilization. We've investigated some very strange, bizarre, present-day happenings. And we've taken a searching look into what promises to be an incredible future. There are questions that loom
ever larger the more we investigate. Many mysteries remain. Are we the children of ancient spacemen? Did those astronauts of millions of years ago visit the Earth? Did they give of their knowledge to the Earth's earliest civilizations? What are the mysteries of the genetic code, of the Nazca Plains, of the Crystal Skull? And what of the future? We've heard startling predictions on what may happen in the very near future, the day after tomorrow, and from our own NASA scientists on what the distant future may hold. There remains a most haunting and persistent question. Are we alone? Or truly, is there life beyond our galaxy? Certainly the efforts of our most knowledgeable scientists and our government belie an easy answer. Are beings or intelligences from beyond our galaxy listening to us as we are trying to listen to them? And a most disturbing, unsettling question, echoed by laymen and scientists alike. Are we somehow, in some inexplicable way, being prepared by an intelligence beyond our own for our first encounter with extraterrestrial beings? Think on it. Am I being prepared for this encounter? Are you? How soon? This is not the work of fiction. This is not the work of dreamers. No. Consider this, how true it becomes when, in the end, science takes over from the imagination. And behold, there are even greater wonders than we dreamed.